Amen, amen. Amen, amen. What's up, y'all? It's good to see you guys here on our live stream of True Life Christian Church. Welcome. It is our first weekend in June, and we want to simply say thank you for being plugged in, for connecting with us. Of course, my ask is that you would share with someone else our link. This word, this message for this season. But most importantly, man, I'm just thankful to be the pastor of True Life Christian Church, man. So welcome, welcome, welcome. Let's kind of just go through our flow of the day. And as always, I'm excited to share with you guys what God has placed on my heart to share with you. I know that it is the top of the month, and communion is something that we've not done in the last couple months, and please forgive me because I have neglected to give you guys a proper warning or give you the proper time to prepare. But what I would ask is if you do have the ability to, at some point while we're live today, grab yourself a cracker and some juice. If you got some grape juice in your fridge, grab some grape juice. I would like to share communion with you guys today. Maybe you got some apple juice in there. We just want to be symbolic of his broken body and his shed blood. Amen. And so I know that during these times, we do have to make changes as needed. Amen. Listen, I'm excited. I am going to pray with you guys. And in my praying, I'm going to ask that you pray with me and pray for me as we prepare for today's word. Of course, I'm going to share a song of worship with you, and I'm going to share the word with you. And then, of course, after all is said and done, I am going to hopefully there's enough time for us to partake of the Lord's body and his blood. Amen. So, dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you, God, for today. Father, I pray away the spirit of heaviness even now. I pray away, God, the weightier things in life that seem to overload us, Father. I pray even now, God, that you would intervene right at this moment, right at this time, right at this hour, Father, that you would begin to intervene and you would begin to lift that heaviness off of us, Father, and you would allow us to experience the freedom and the grace and the confidence that we need to continue pressing closer to you in this season. Father, I can't echo it enough that our line of sight has to be on you. Our gaze has to be toward you, Father, and we have to remember what you've done and how you lead and the example that you've made for us. We pray even now, God, that you would touch everyone that is represented here in this moment and the moments to come, God, whether they watch now or whether they watch later. Father, my prayer is the same, God, that you would move on their behalf, every area in their lives, Father, where they've been looking for you. Thank you, Father. Every area in their lives, Father, where they've been looking for you, Father, I pray that you would reveal yourself, that you would show up even now, God, that you would make yourself visible for those that are looking for you to see. Father, we want to acknowledge you in everything that we do, and every step that we take. We want you to go before us. So we ask even now, God, that you would just cover us with your glory, with your love and your grace. It is in the mighty name of Jesus that we do pray. And all of you that are listening with me, say amen. Amen, amen. Listen, I'm going to share a song with you, and then we are going to jump right into the word. We have a new series this month. I'm going to share the series topic with you in a moment. But for the time being, let's worship together, and give God some glory. Amen.
Let our worship rise tonight, God. We'll pour our love on you. Break open our box. Give you everything. From here to there, worship is filling the air.
there both now and then. Songs of your love will never end. All day and night, as we bow down, our praise will rise inside and down. All that I am will shout.
Let my worship rise like a sweet perfume. For my love, all over you.
From here,
from here
to there,
to there, worship is filling the atmosphere.
Now and then.
Sweet perfume, I'll pour my love.
Today? Is there a song that's on your heart? Is there a worship on the inside of you?
God sings over us tonight.
The only thing that's going to really break the heaviness in your life is if you begin to sing a song that will lift that heaviness even now. You got to open your mouth. And you got to start pouring out your love to God. Every time you open your mouth, it becomes the signal that you're trying to get God's attention. You're looking for God to show up in some spaces. You got to start opening your mouth in those same spaces. And you've got to start creating a sound of worship in those spaces where God can show up. The light penetrates the darkness. But that light shines as you begin to worship. As that song begins to fester on the inside of you. It begins to open something up. And then as he's singing, he says, God will begin to fill every void. And he'll pour out his love. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, God. Pour out your love, Father. In a world filled with hate, Lord, pour out your love even now, God. And then I'll pour mine out. I'll give you back my worship, God. I'll open my mouth and give you glory in the spaces where I know you deserve it, God. Thank you, Jesus. I know it's hard to worship through this phone. But we've got to find that space where we can start penetrating the atmosphere in worship. I give you everything, God. And I'm going to pour out my love to you, God, not because of anything other than you deserve it, God. Yes, Father, I'll pour out my love to you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, God, you are worthy to be praised, and we just give you glory, Father. Thank you, Father, so much, God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yes, God, you fill every void, Father. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Amen, amen, amen. Amen. I wish we were together where we could worship together. Ah, amen. The limitations of our times definitely are felt in moments like this. Where you know we just need to press our way into the atmosphere where we can experience him at that next level. Amen. Listen, I won't keep you too long. If you would turn with me to John chapter 2. John chapter 2. John chapter 2, and we're going to start at verse 13, John chapter 2, verse 13, and so the series topic that I feel led to start is speak up. Our series topic is speak up, and I think that in the climate that we are in right now, requires it requires us to be engaging to a greater degree. It requires us to be engaging to a greater degree. And of course, with everything that's going on right now, I've somewhat had my eyes glued to not only CNN, but I've had my eyes glued to social media. And I know that we have, we are being extremely proactive in making our voices heard in this season. We're being very deliberate about the message that we are sharing. And in that space where we're being intentional and very deliberate about the message, I think it's important for us to be deliberate and intentional about the message of Jesus Christ. For me, and for us at True Life, the month of June was really dedicated toward evangelism. The month of June was intended for us to be very intentional about going out and sharing the good news of Jesus Christ. And as God would have it, we are in a very different season in terms of how we are engaging people and the fact that we are still social distancing. You know, many of us have not been afforded the opportunity to come together, but we've been utilizing our platforms to share a message. And so one of the things that I saw floating across social media as we are trying to really understand the frustration, the hurt and the pain of Black people specifically, we're trying our best to articulate that pain. We're trying our best to understand how we engage others and how we drive a conversation. And so I know that some of our pain has also been exploited. Amen. Our pain has been exploited, and it has been taken advantage of in a time where things are very vulnerable and touchy. And so one of the memes that I saw floating across social media as we have witnessed the rioting, and I'll just leave it at the rioting, as we've witnessed the rioting, I know that the rioting has made many people uncomfortable in an attempt to find some comfort in what's going on. I saw a meme that was floating across social media that referenced Jesus flipping over the table. Amen. Some of y'all saw it. If you saw it, you just wave your hand in the comment section. Amen. Some of us saw the meme where they were talking about Jesus knocked over the tables. And it was as if we were utilizing the scripture to justify rioting. Amen. It was as if we were utilizing the scripture to justify rioting. And so me being who I am, I feel it's important for us as we talk about how we use our platform and how we share the message and how we talk about Jesus, it's important for us to recognize that there are moments and times where we have to speak up. There are moments and times where when we witness something that's taking place that should not be taking place, there is a voice and a cry of those that are witnessing what's going on who have to be bold enough and courageous enough to speak up and speak to what they know is out of line and out of order. And so I never give you guys anything concerning lifestyle or how you walk or how you live without giving you what the good book says. And so I'm going to utilize that same scripture where Jesus is flipping over the table to give us some context to what was really taking place here in this particular time in history. Now, I'm a huge believer that history repeats itself. And so much of what you are seeing, even as you witness what's going on with the lives of minorities in the lives of Black people right now, you see the exploitation of who they are. You see how someone is trying to capitalize on the greater good that should be achieved in the moment. And you're going to see that same thing here in the text. So here in John, the second chapter, starting at verse number 13, what you will see is, you'll see these words recorded. And the Bible says, the Passover of the Jews was at hand, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple, he found those who were selling oxen and sheep and pigeons and the money changers sitting there. The first thing that I want to say is you're going to see a couple of accounts of this taking place. But what happened is there were two times where Jesus has to set the record straight. There are two times in history, in biblical history, where Jesus has to get on and he has to clean the temple. So what we see here in the text is Jesus is just coming out of Capernaum. And this is at the beginning of his ministry. When you look at the other account, one of the other accounts is penned in Matthew. And Matthew says that this is taking place at the latter part of the ministry of Jesus when he cleans the temple, according to Matthew's account. But we're going to look at John's account, because John's account is referencing when Jesus is cleaning the temple at the very beginning of his ministry. And so the Bible says that Passover of the Jews was at hand. And what Jesus found when he went to the temple is he saw them basically bartering. Amen. He saw them bartering. So what we have to understand, or what we should know as we look at the text, when we are witnessing the fact that Passover has taken place, what you know is everybody from all of the surrounding regions had come together in an attempt to celebrate their victory from walking out of Egypt. So really, Passover was this moment in time after the death angel had come. We know the story. After the death angel had come, the death angel was visiting the homes. And the only way that the death angel would not come to your home is if there was the blood, the sacrificial blood, over the door and on the doorpost of the homes. And at that point, we knew that that particular home was covered, and Passover happened in that regard. And so this was after they had been freed and they have come out of the land of Egypt, and now they are dealing at a different level. So just to give you context to what's going on. So here we are, they're celebrating Passover. People from all over the place have now come. They've come together so that they can worship together. They've come that they can celebrate Passover. And as this is happening, and I guess what I would say in terms of this, what you are witnessing is the masses of people coming together. Now, I know you're watching social media and you're seeing the masses of people coming together. And although we are not yet celebrating our victory, what we are celebrating is our freedom. What we are celebrating is very, very much like what the people of God are celebrating here as they are celebrating Passover. So you are witnessing everything that's taking place. But in the moment where you are witnessing what's taking place, you see, Jesus sees that they are selling oxen, they are selling sheep, and they are selling pigeons, and the money changers are sitting in the temple. What has happened here in the text is oftentimes there was what is known as a temple tax. And so what you have is you have those that are exchanging currency that are sitting in the temple. But what has happened is, because of the mass number of people that are here and what is taking place, many of the money changers and many of those that are selling the oxen and the sheep, the reason that they're selling the oxen and the sheep is that they needed something to sacrifice. And because they were traveling from other regions, they did not have or didn't have the ability to bring something to sacrifice. So what they did bring was they brought their coin. But because of where they were at that time, there was only two particular types of currency that was acceptable at that time. So you had to have the money changers there, and you had to have those that were selling in the temple, and all of that was not necessarily deemed out of order. What Jesus is witnessing is, he's witnessing how they are now exploiting the opportunity of those that are there. So they know that they came to sacrifice. They know that they came to worship. They know that they came to a place for a particular purpose. But when they got to the temple, what Jesus witnessed was the merchants that were selling at a higher rate. And those that were exchanging the currency were exchanging the currency at a greater rate. Amen. So what we are witnessing is, we are witnessing how those that have had power and those that are in control of the economic structure and those that have the ability to really impede this moment of worship, they are exploiting the moment and taking advantage of the people. And so Jesus, being who he is, He recognizes what's taking place, but he does not sit or remain silent. He uses this as an opportunity, not only to teach a lesson, but to set the record straight. So the first thing that I want to say to you is, in all of your observations and everything that you are witnessing, you have to be able to witness what is proper order and what is out of order. Amen. I'm going to say it again. You have to be able to witness what is proper order and what is out of order. And so when Jesus walks into the temple, what he begins to witness as he walks into the temple, or let me use you as an example, what you have to be strategic in doing is, as you are witnessing those around you talk about Jesus, or as you are witnessing those around you talk about the movement, or as you are witnessing those around you talk about their solidarity and how they're going to stand and be unified, what we have to witness in everything that we do, we have to witness what is proper order and what is out of order. And so for far too long, we allow things to exist in a space where we don't speak up and speak to the things that we know are out of order. You know that something's out of alignment. You know that something is not where it should be. You know that the spirit of what you are dealing with doesn't bear the spirit of God. And we will go, and let me even take it to this level. We will go into churches. We will spend times in different places. We will listen to a word. We will let someone speak a word into our lives. Words that we know are not in alignment with what God is saying. But because it sounds good in the moment, and because someone recognizes their opportunity to take advantage and to exploit a moment where we should be releasing true worship, where we should be unified and releasing one sound, we allow pure chaos to exist in the spaces around us. And if we are not bold enough to speak up, we will witness a generation that misses God. We will witness an entire generation if no one is bold enough to correct. Listen, what I'm trying to say to you is, Jesus didn't flip the table over just because he was mad and because he wanted to create chaos. Jesus did not flip the table over because he wanted to upset everything that was going on. Jesus flipped the temple. He flipped the table over because he was trying to reestablish order. Now, I would give you my cliff notes. And what my cliff notes say is, he was actually trying to prevent a riot. The Bible says that many of the religious lawmakers, many of the scribes and Pharisees, many of those that would set the order in and around the place, or the place of worship. Let me say it to you this way. People were always waiting for the opportunity to lock Jesus up. Amen. People are waiting for the opportunity for you to do something that's out of line. And the moment you step out of line, they've got a scope on you waiting to take advantage of you in that moment and say, we knew Jesus was up to no good. We knew that if we gave Jesus enough rope, we knew that if we gave Jesus enough time, if we gave him enough room, he would create a scenario worthy of being locked up. But we already know that the Bible has already said, no spot or blemish was found on him. We already know the Bible has already declared that he had done nothing wrong, that they could find no guilt in him, that he had never done anything unworthy or unjust. He was always found establishing order. So in everything that you do, and all of your protesting, and in all of your witnessing, and in every moment where God is ushering you or pushing you to be the presence, hear me, where God is ushering you to be the presence of the Holy Ghost in that moment, you got to establish order. And the moment you see something that's out of pocket, speak to it. When you go to spread the good news, when God is using you to establish order, when God has given you a voice worthy of being heard in the earth, you have to make sure that you take advantage of the moment. But in taking advantage of the moment, you got to walk in order and in your full authority. So the next thing that we witness the authority of Jesus as he walks into the temple. You have to understand the authority that you have as a representative of Christ. As an ambassador of Christ, you have been given a level of authority where you can walk into spaces and speak to things that everybody else can't speak to. Let me say it to you this way. There are many people that will not speak to it because they are okay with things being out of order. And so what we witness here is if people continued here, biblically speaking, if people continue to walk without order, if people continue to walk without order, they would miss the moment of worship. If they continue to walk without order, they would miss the moment of worship, because what would happen is the exploitation of what was going on, someone would catch a hold of what was going on. And just as we're witnessing today, the moment we recognize that exploitation is taking place, we're like, yo, wait, we're trying to push back. And so Jesus comes in. And in verse 15, it says, and making a whip of cords, he drove them all out of the temple with the sheep and with the oxen. And he poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. He didn't overturn their tables just because he was upset that they were there. He overturned the tables because the order that should have been established was missed. And so the first thing that we have to do is we have to make sure that we're speaking to order. And the second thing that we have to do is take action. Now, this is the part where you speak up. This is the part where you open your mouth. And so in verse 15, what you see Jesus do, you see Jesus recognize what is happening. And the moment he recognizes it, he institutes a plan so that he can reestablish order. He institutes a plan so that he can reestablish order. And what Jesus knew, he knew that if he allowed the people to maintain their space in the temple, that he would not be able to gain control over the situation. And so what happens with us, spiritually speaking, is if we don't clear house, amen, if you do not detox yourself of all of the things that you allow to exist in your space, if you don't allow a transformative moment to happen, if you don't allow a cleansing to take place where you purge everything that would keep you out of alignment, what happens is you will never be able to reestablish the order. And so he drives out everything in the temple that existed in that moment to create chaos. So what's that look like for you? What does it look like for you to drive out? Yo, sometimes the only way you can dismantle things is to give it truth. Sometimes the only way to dismantle things is to give it truth, but to understand from a historical perspective what has happened. Yo, what we've been fighting against, this thing that we're trying to establish, is not something new. I was reading the Bible, and I don't want to lose you guys. I don't want to be all over the place, but I was reading the Bible. I was reading in the book of Acts. And in the book of Acts, it talked about, I want to say it's chapter 13. In chapter 13, in the book of Acts, probably later down in like maybe verse 38 or somewhere in there, it talks about the children of Israel, amen, having had to struggle for 450 years. Actually, what I'm going to do, just because I want us to really understand and establish order here, in terms of what God needs us to do. It says here, this is Acts chapter 13. I'm going to read for you starting at verse 16. It says, so Paul stood up and motioning with his hand said, and he's quoting, men of Israel and you who fear God, listen. The God of this people, Israel, chose our fathers and made the people great during their stay in the land of Egypt. And with uplifted arm, he led them out of it. Okay? So he's saying, hey, God used our ancestors to establish something. Hear me. God used our ancestors to establish something. And he made them great during their time in Egypt. And so what that means is they increased. Amen. I hope this resonates with you. Amen. During the history of us being here in America, we have increased greatly. Amen. And with uplifted arm, he led them out of it. And for about 40 years, he put up with them in the wilderness. And after destroying seven nations in the land of Canaan, he gave them their land as an inheritance. The Bible says here in verse 20, all this took about 450 years. Amen. About 450 years, people were struggling with the same thing. About 450 years, the people of God were struggling with the same level of oppression. About 450 years, we are still trying our best to be heard as a group of people. After about 450 years, we're still trying to gain the acceptance in certain regions and places. We're still trying our best to be heard to the greatest degree. But what we have to understand, just like the children of Israel, they had to allow themselves to fully surrender to the leading of God and for God to take them to the place of their inheritance. Listen, I know that we are dealing with a very tumultuous time and it's extremely complicated to navigate these terrains of ethnicity and our culture. Everything feels like it's stacked against us. But what I always stand on is the word of God. And God's word has already proven to us that there is going to be a moment where we will overcome. There is going to be a moment where you will stand and experience the true freedom and liberation that God intended for you to have. And you will have the opportunity to physically walk into your place of inheritance. But sometimes it only happens when God has been given complete control to lead. And so if we are going to ever walk into the thing that God has established for us. And I know that I'm talking in duality right now because I'm talking about your spiritual inheritance, but I'm also talking about the very physical thing that you believe God for here in the earth. And the two are the same in terms of how we get to that place. We only get to that place by standing on the word of God. We only get to our inheritance by trusting that God is leading us to a place that we cannot get on our own. And so what I'm saying to you is, we've got to allow the Holy Spirit to speak a word to us in terms of how we get from point A to point B. We've got to allow the Holy Spirit to lead us in terms of how we purge out and how we cleanse so that we can begin to reestablish control for the place of worship so that God can be glorified. I submit to you. I submit to you that all of this is greatly hinged on the level of worship that we release to God. I know it sounds crazy to some of y'all. You're like, yo, how is my worship going to fix the problem with humanity? How is my worship going to fix the fact that when I walk out the door, there's a whole group of people that don't like me simply because of my skin? Well, what did Jesus do? Because all I'm saying to you as a believer is, what do you have to stand on other than this? Because if I'm not mistaken, the same Jesus that we believe in, the same Jesus that died on the cross, the same Jesus that hung his head and had to bleed from his side, that's the same guy. That's the same guy who had to experience persecution. He's the same guy who was hated on everywhere he went. He's the same guy that every time he walked out the door, people were waiting on the opportunity to say, yo, I know y'all ain't messing with Jesus like that. They were trying their best to discredit everything that he did. So all I'm saying to you is, we've seen this narrative before. All I'm suggesting to you is, we've seen the narrative before and we see God prevail even over that. We see God's plan prevail over every attack that came Jesus' way. We see God's plan come to fruition every time. And our goal in this season, as we speak up, is to represent the kingdom. Our goal in this season is to lead people back, because the only love we know is the love of the Father. Because the only love that's going to change humanity is the love of the Father. the only thing that's going to change these dark hearts is that we would allow God to feel the darkness that exists in the hearts of humanity. And so your role, you don't have a temple to walk into and flip the table over, but what you do have is a platform to stand on God's word and let people know, if you don't turn back to Jesus, if you don't put Jesus at the center of everything that you do, your heart is never going to be right. And just like all of those, let me say it to you this way. Jesus was also challenged with the responsibility. Hear me. Jesus was also challenged with the responsibility to not be overtaken by the hatred that existed for him. Jesus had the same responsibility not to be overtaken by the same hatred that was cascaded in his direction. Same Jesus had to deal with it. He had to deal with that same level of hate, that same level of this. I know that you're furious. I know you're upset every time you walk out the door, every time you turn on the TV. I know you want to flip the table over. But Jesus, in the book of John chapter 2, the reason that Jesus flipped the table over is not because he's trying to incite a riot. The reason that he flipped the table over is because he's trying to establish order. And so if you're going to flip a table to establish order, go for it. But if you're flipping a table to incite a riot, you out of order. If you're going to kick the door in and let people know Jesus is the only way that this changes, then I'm standing with you and I got your back. But don't call Pastor Tim to come bail you out if you are acting a fool. Amen? I ain't coming. Maybe I'll show up. But if you are using your platform and using this moment to say, listen, I know it's rough. I know you feel the heaviness. Jesus felt it too. I know it feels like I know the children of Israel for 450 years after they struggle with being oppressed at the hand of Pharaoh. I know that after they wandered in the wilderness because of their disobedience. I know that after 450 years, they got frustrated. And yes, there were generations that had not seen it. But there was a generation. There was a generation that was able to cross over into that place of promise and walk into the inheritance and experience the glory of God and receive everything that God had been waiting to release. And I'm crazy enough to believe that we are that generation as well. That we are that same generation that will open our mouths and make a boast in the Lord. Amen. And as we open our mouths and make a boast in the Lord, then God will give us a word to release. Then he will give us the words to speak so that he can be glorified and humanity can be reconciled back to him. Because that is the goal. That is the mission. That is what evangelism looks like in this season. That we would go out and we would deliver the good news. And in all your giving, give people the truth. I know it's hard and it's difficult to deal with it. But understand that God is in control of all things. Amen. And so that's what I'm saying to you today. I know that I'm pushing my time limit. And so what I want you to walk away with today is that as you observe what's going on and as you witness what's going on, make sure you speak to the order. The reason that Jesus walks through the door and he's upset is because he recognizes that things are not as they should be. And I know we recognize that things are not as they should be, not only in the natural, but also in the spirit. And so I'm challenging you in this season. I'm challenging you in this season to speak up. I'm challenging you in this season to let your voice be heard. I'm challenging you in this season to be the platform for righteousness. I'm challenging you in this season to spread the good news. And so what that means is maybe it simply suggests that in those moments where people are talking about chaos and nonsense, that you redirect that conversation back to a conversation of holiness and righteousness. This is the season where we speak up. This is the season where we recognize what's happening to us spiritually and naturally. And listen, people are walking away from the faith. People are giving up on God because they haven't believed. And that's not new. That happened biblically. There are a lot of people. That's why the Bible talks about the remnant that would still believe. Y'all should check out Bible class on Tuesdays at 7 via Zoom. That way you can understand what I'm saying in terms of some of this stuff is just historical things that play out again in other forms and other times in history. But understand this, that prophetic wording always gets us to the place that God wants us to be in. Amen. Amen. Listen, I know that we are approaching our hour mark, and so I want to be intentional with the time. I want to be very intentional with our time. I believe that God is going to use this. Thank you, Holy Ghost. I believe that God is going to use this time in this season for revival to happen. I honestly believe that that this is a season for revival to happen. We have to revive the believers. We've got to revive those that once believed and have walked away. We've got to revive those where we recognize that life, spiritual life, is barely holding on. We got to be very diligent to revive those. And so I'm challenging you this week. Listen, over the next 7 days, I want you to be intentional about sharing a word. I don't care if it's on social media. I don't care if it's in person. I don't care if you got to email or text somebody. I want you to be intentional about sharing the good news. There's a lot of bad news going on. There's a lot of heaviness that's going on. And you may be the key factor in someone's connection staying intact. Amen. So that's my challenge for you this week. Over the next 7 days, I want you to take every day over the next 7 days, and I want you to share a word that others need to hear. Amen. Listen, if you are not connected to a church, if you don't have some place where you are attending regularly, and I know that right now regular attendance is via social media and YouTube and things of that nature, but if you don't have a place where you're being fed the word, listen, we want to be that place for you. We want to be a place where you can worship, where you can grow, where you can mature. We want to walk out, amen, your spiritual journey with you. If that's you, if you don't have a place, if you're looking for a place, I'm simply saying that I want to be that guy that helps you get to that place in God that He intends for you to be, a place of purpose and a place of destiny. Listen, I want you to pray this prayer with me. God, I believe you. Thank you, Father. I believe you. Repeat that. God, I believe you. I believe that you sent your son. I believe your son died for my sins. And I believe his blood makes me new. I believe in my heart and I confess with my mouth that Jesus is Lord. Listen, we believe that if you pray that prayer, that you've experienced salvation. We want your spiritual life to grow and blossom. We want to hear you in your prophetic utterance. We want to hear you speak your heavenly language. We want to see you grow and mature over time. We want to be a part of that journey. Listen, if you're looking for a place to connect, you can always send us a DM right at True Life Christian Church on Instagram or Facebook. You can visit our website, wearetruelife.org. We will respond. We want to be a part of your journey, and we love you with the love of God. I know that time is pressing. I don't know if you guys had the opportunity to get your juice and your cracker, but I want to administer the Lord's Supper to you. So I'm going to read for you really quickly. Here these verses. This is 1 Corinthians chapter 11 and verse 23. It says, "For I have received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, Amen. When he had given thanks, I have to get my cracker, amen. When he had given thanks, and God, we thank you for your broken body, he broke it. And he said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And in the same way, he took a cup. Amen. He took a cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat of this bread and drink of this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Amen. Whosoever therefore eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty concerning the body and the blood of the Lord. Let a person examine himself then, and so eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For anyone who drinks and eats without discerning the body eats and drinks judgment on himself. Amen. Listen, we want to pray this prayer with you. Father, we thank you right now, God, for what you've done by the life of your son, Jesus. God, we don't take for granted what he has done on Calvary. God, we don't gloss over the horrific experiences that he went through. And we know that as he was beaten and whipped, dragged from judgment hall to judgment hall, that God, as you allowed him to be lifted on that cross, you allowed him to be lifted on that cross for Calvary for us, Father, that his blood would cover a multitude of sin, that his blood would be the remission of sin, that his blood would be the access that we get back to you, Father. And so right now we say thank you. And so listen, take that bread, take that cracker, break it. Let's eat together. Amen. And then let's drink together and think of Calvary. Listen, people of God, I love you so much. I want the best thing for you. I want you to understand that this season is super critical in terms of you speaking up and you being a voice for the kingdom. In the midst of everything else that's going on, God needs you. He needs an ambassador. He needs someone who will testify, who will share a word, who will be the representation of holiness in a time of ungodliness. Listen, I love you guys. Until next time, I look forward to seeing you guys on Tuesday for Bible class via Zoom. And until then, I'll see you next Saturday, where we will continue our discussion, our series, our June series on Speak Up. Amen. I love you guys. And of course, as always, I'll leave you with a little bit of worship until they kick me off of the live. Amen. I love you guys. And I'll see you soon. Amen.